students. Today we're going to begin a very interesting topic that perhaps the ladies in the room will be more interested in learning about. Our topic this week is entitled husbandry. So if you are in the market for looking for a husband in the future, this topic is for you. No, no, no. Actually, I'm completely joking. The topic of husbandry has absolutely nothing with finding a husband. So relax. I'm not forcing you into marriage here, ladies or gentlemen. No need to look for a husband. But rather, husbandry has a meaning that you might not be aware of. So some of you, if you have an agricultural background, may have heard this word before. The rest of you might be like, well, what is husbandry if it's not about finding a husband? Well, let me tell you, that's why we're here, to find out about this topic called husbandry. Husbandry, woo, lights went off there for a moment. Husbandry is about the selective cultivation of plants or animals for human use. All of us, whether we have an agricultural background or not, like to eat. We all need to eat food. Some of you might be meat eaters. Some of you might not be meat eaters. That's okay. Then you still have to eat plants or derivatives from those products. And we have to eat in order to stay alive. Well, if you're in the agricultural field, then you know a little bit about plants and animals and the importance of those plants and or animals for human use. Whether we're consuming them or using materials from them to clothe ourselves, or whatever the case might be. And husbandry has been a very integral, very important part of this process for thousands of years, believe it or not. So husbandry is the selective. Well, let's look at these words here. Selective has to do with selection, selecting something or choosing certain characteristics. The selective cultivation, meaning the propagation or the producing of crops or one generation after another. So choosing the generations of plants or animals, and more specifically, desirable characteristics of those plants or animals for human use or our use. So the selective cultivation of plants or animals for human use is basically saying, hey, we need raw materials from plants or animals in order to survive or make our lives easier. So we're going to choose certain characteristics of those plants and animals for our use. That's what husbandry is all about. And generally speaking, there are four methods of husbandry. And we're going to spend this week talking about all four of these. The first one is called selective breeding. The second one is hybridization. The third one, inbreeding. And finally, the fourth one is cloning. Now, based on some videos we saw previously, and based on the topic we're going to talk about next week, we might even add another method of husbandry, which is genetic engineering, but we'll save that for next week. Okay, so each of these different methods we're going to expand upon in more detail, starting with first, selective breeding. By the way, I'll comment that after we finish our lesson here today, I am going to be linking you to some videos that can be found hyperlinked to a lot of the pictures in the lesson today and tomorrow. For copyright reasons, I'm not going to link you to them within my own video, but I'm going to link you to these other videos when we're finished with our lesson, and I want you to make sure you do watch them. If, in fact, you can't get to these videos through Google Classroom, then go through the notes online on the website, and you will be able to link to them there. All right, so that being said, let's get to our notes now. Number one, selective breeding, the first method of husbandry. This is a process that has been taking place for literally thousands of years, ever since the agricultural revolution thousands of years ago. Humans have been crossing plants or animals with desirable characteristics. Now, what does that word crossing mean? Well, think of Punnett squares from earlier in the year. The crossing of two parents with a Punnett square. It's kind of what we're doing here with selective breeding. It's choosing a male and choosing a female with certain characteristics that we want carried down to the next generation in the offspring. And so we cross them. We encourage them to reproduce. There are various ways of encouraging that reproduction, and those methods have changed over the years, but it's basically taking a plant or an animal with desirable characteristics and enabling them to reproduce. Now, if you look at these two pictures here, the one on the left, do you know what those are? They are all carrots. And they're all carrots. Now, we're probably most familiar with orange carrots that you buy in the grocery store. But did you know you can actually grow carrots with different colors, from purple to black to red and yellow and orangey yellow to a light yellow? All of these are carrots, and I've actually eaten them, and they all taste pretty much the same. They all taste like carrots. But you could go to the grocery store or a seed store, and you can actually buy packets of seeds and grow different colored carrots yourself. It's pretty cool. Now, why would you do that? Well, because it's neat. And seeds have been selected for different colored carrots. Wild carrots come in a variety of colors. Now, over time, we have selected orange to be the most desirable color for carrots for some reason. Why? I'm not exactly sure why, but most people, when they think of carrots or go to the grocery store to buy carrots, they're going to buy orange carrots because that's what we have selectively bred them to be. But carrots do exist in a variety of other colors, and you can selectively choose those other colors. And as I said, you can actually grow carrots of different colors. Now, what about over on the right-hand side? Believe it or not, all of those pictures are of corn. Now, you're probably most familiar with the biggest ear of corn and the ear of corn that has the most kernels on it. But did you know that wild corn started thousands of years ago looking like this? But over the centuries, we have selectively bred seeds from ears that are bigger and better than the previous generation until we now have ears of corn that look like this. In nature, nature's corn looks more like this. We have, again, selectively bred it for the desirable characteristic of more kernels and bigger ears. And who doesn't look forward to biting into and consuming ears of corn, freshly cooked or baked with a picnic? Oh my goodness. In fact, just thinking about it, my mouth is watering for summer to come so that we can have a picnic at home and get nice juicy ears of corn and just lather it with butter and just devour it layer by layer by layer. I just chomp on my ears from one side to the other side and then back again until I have consumed the whole thing. By the way, I'm curious, do any of you eat ears of corn going all the way around the ear, one mouth length at a time? Or do any of you chew an entire row of kernels off and work your way back again? I work back and forth myself, but you might have a preference. But let's continue with our notes. So again, selective breeding is the producing of offspring with those desirable characteristics. And as I have mentioned, has been going on for thousands of years. The ancient Egyptians actually recorded images in their hieroglyphics, in their narratives, in their paintings, in such a way to educate future generations as to how this was accomplished. And we have been doing it in the Americas, in North and South America, for thousands of years, going from the original ears of corn to the more desirable, bigger ears of corn. But again, husbandry, in the sense of selective breeding, is not a difficult thing. It just takes generations to be successful. Here are some examples, closer to home, you might say. If you are a dairy farmer, if you have a herd of milk-producing cows, you want cows that produce more milk. So what do? Generation after generation, you're going to choose the best milk producers in your herd, and you're going to encourage them to breed with bulls in order to produce cows that produce more milk, so that you can get more milk from your investment of feed and upkeep with your cows. Just makes sense. If you raise sheep, and if you raise sheep for the wool, you're going to intentionally breed the best wool-producing sheep in order to produce these luxurious coats. Here is a sheep that has only been half sheared, and look at the thickness of that wool on this sheep. Not only is that a cool picture, but boy, that's a lot of wool. I've heard that some really good sheep shearers can remove or shear the coat of wool all in one sitting, in one coat, you might say. That takes a lot of talent. But hey, if you've got clothes that you have, blankets that are made out of wool, wool is a great fiber for making different fabrics. Where does it come from? It comes from sheep. Maybe you have goats that produce it as well. But if you are in the business of selling sheep wool, then you're going to want to produce sheep with more wool. Or say you raise hens. I used to have a profitable business myself. As many of you know, my first name is Henry. And so I had a business when I was a teenager that I called Hens, because I had a flock of about two dozen hens, and I raised them for their eggs. And my mother used to help me sell the eggs, and we made a profit. I made a couple bucks a month, really. That was not much of a profit, but it was enough to pay for the feed and the upkeep of the hens with a little left over, a couple bucks a month for spending money. Well, 40 years ago, that was more money than it is today. But yeah, you want to have hens that lay more eggs if you're in the egg business. Or if you are in the agricultural business and you're a farmer that grows certain crops, you want to plant crops that produce more. You want the best seeds. And in fact, you'll probably buy seeds that have been selectively bred for certain characteristics, whether it's corn or soybean or some other crop that you may grow, in order to produce a greater yield. Why? for all of these reasons, basically for profit. You want to get the most bang for your buck, the most return for your investment. It's just common sense to desire that, and selective breeding can get you there. Another example of why selective breeding might be done is to grow plants that resist disease. Think about this for a moment. Let's say you're making salad and you go to the grocery store and you want to buy some tomatoes. Are you going to buy tomatoes from the store that are all rotting and oozing out their tomato juice and are mushy and growing mold? Certainly not. You're going to choose the firmest, healthiest looking tomatoes. And there are ways to selectively breed tomatoes and other plants for that matter that will resist disease so that they look better, taste better, and aren't susceptible to a lot of, well, bacterial diseases, viral diseases, critter infestations, what have you. That brings us to number two. The second method of husbandry is called hybridization. Hybridization is done when you cross genetically different but related species. Crossing genetically different but related species. We have some pictures here of how this can be done with plants and animals and or animals. So let's elaborate more with hybridization. And don't forget to watch the videos at the end of the lesson. There are different ways of achieving hybridization. One of them is called natural hybridization. These kinds of hybrids actually do occur in nature. One example is wheat. Wheat is one of the staple grains that are very essential for populations around the world. It's one of the biggest staple grains in the United States and other countries too, but a lot of our products are made with wheat or wheat germ, which is part of the seeds. But hybrids that are produced in nature, like wheat, are called natural hybrids. And these natural hybrids can actually occur by themselves due to cross-pollination with different varieties of grains. And then we as people select those that are most desirable. But it can also be done artificially. Artificial hybridization is when it is forced by humans. Probably the most famous example is when we take a donkey and a horse, cause them to breed with one another artificially, and the result is a mule. So here we have a picture of interspecific hybridization, which means between two different species, but of the same genus. And if you think of the taxonomic classification scale, that you may recall species and genuses and what they mean. So here we have a horse on the left, and a horse is a horse, of course, of course. And a horse has 64 chromosomes. Over on the right, we have a donkey, and a donkey has only 62 chromosomes. Normally, horses and donkeys don't get together to have offspring, but it can be forced upon them by human introduction. Now, because they have a different number of chromosomes, there are some drawbacks to forcing a horse and a donkey to mate with one another. First, let's talk about, and we'll get to that in a moment, but first, let me mention this thing that is called hybrid vigor. You see, hybrid vigor is essentially the desired traits, whether it's stronger or healthier offspring. It's what a person practicing husbandry is looking for. It's the end game. If you're dealing with animals or plants, you want the offspring to be stronger or healthier. That's called hybrid vigor. Hybrid vigor is looking for the most desirable traits. But here's the outcome. When looking for artificial hybridization in particular, the offspring are not able to reproduce. And it's because you are trying to cause or force two different species to reproduce. Now, one of the definitions of a species, as you may recall from earlier in the year, is the fact that a species is so unique and specially designed and distinguished from other species that they can only interbreed among themselves. Well, when hybridization takes place, as in the case of the horse and the mule, or the donkey producing a mule, if you try to breed mules together, they will not be able to reproduce because they're not a true species. They're a hybrid. And so the offspring of these interspecies hybrids are sterile. They are unable to reproduce. So we're not going to get to the third one yet today. We're going to stop there because I have a number of videos that I'd like you to watch regarding the first two methods of husbandry. So we'll call it quits there for now, but I'd like to discuss the videos after you have an opportunity to watch them as they are linked for you in Google Classroom. So until next time, I'll say bye-bye.